the American Heart Association, the American College of Cardiology, has not had a comprehensive document such as this before that targets both the patient as well as the healthcare provider. What we tried to do was to summarize the latest data about how to better assess one's risk of having a heart attack and stroke. And we also talk about the risk of developing heart failure and atrial fibrillation. We then went into the latest data about aspirin and other blood thinners. We've had several recent studies that have questioned the use of aspirin to try to lower one's risk of a heart attack. We then summarized the data about blood pressure lowering and re-emphasized the fact that lower blood pressures are associated not only with a lower risk of heart attack and stroke, but also heart failure. And we have some recent data that also suggests that lower blood pressures are associated with a lower risk of memory problems or cognitive impairment. The data about cholesterol that was recently presented and published back in November has also been updated, and we now feel much more comfortable with advocating much lower target cholesterol values. The last set of cholesterol guidelines did not really deal with diet, weight, and exercise, and these guidelines have a very strong lifestyle emphasis. We also talk about those individuals who have diabetes and some of the newer classes of medicines that not only lower one's blood sugar and hemoglobin A1C, but significantly lower a person with diabetes risk of developing heart failure or kidney problems. So I think this ABCDE approach is going to be very helpful for primary care providers, for cardiologists, endocrinologists, and even other specialties such as surgeons and OBGYNs to really understand how to convey this information to patients and to provide many manageable tools that will help them in their quest to live a long and healthy life that's not burdened by cardiovascular disease. The cornerstone of prevention is a better dietary and exercise habits. And these guidelines really take the tack that the more meals that we could eat that are of a Mediterranean type of diet, vegetarian, vegan, the better. We talk about trying to minimize both red meat and processed meats such as bacon, sausage, etc. We talk about the dangers of having too much sodium in the diet and also the problems where people have too much in the way of sugary foods in the diet. We also do a nice discussion about diet and weight, the strategies to help people try to lose weight, and emphasize a better approach of trying to lose weight is trying to aim for a pound or two a month as opposed to trying to drop 5 or more pounds in a month. So there's so many more lifestyle factors that really weren't covered in previous guidelines, such as the cholesterol guidelines that were presented back in November of 2018. So I think both the provider and the patient will have so much more useful information about a comprehensive but manageable approach to lower our risk of a heart attack and stroke. It's very important for people to remember that high blood pressure is a very strong risk factor for congestive heart failure, for stroke, as well as coronary artery disease. And a person's arteries can get clogged up with this yellow fattened cholesterol. And we want to do whatever we can to slow that progression and maybe even stabilize the amount of blockages or narrowings that are already in a person's arteries. For blood pressure, we want to try to focus in on the number 130 over 80. We want our blood pressure values as much as possible to be below that level. And we talk a great deal about ways to improve one's dietary and exercise habits. We also talk about the best ways to approach what medicine that one might try and what is the optimal second or perhaps even third medication to add on to. Ideally, we'd like our blood pressure to be less than 120 over 80. And studies show that when you're in that range of 120 over 80, you're so much less likely to develop a heart failure or a stroke or a heart attack later in life. These new American Heart Association, American College of Cardiology guidelines talk about the latest strategies to help people get off of cigarettes. Tobacco addiction is probably the number one preventable cause of heart attacks and strokes in this country. And we talk both about behavioral techniques to help people get off of cigarettes, as well as review the latest data about the medications that seem to be the most effective. We also talk about electronic cigarettes, and we know that many young people seem to get hooked on e-cigarettes. Ideally, they were developed to help people get off of cigarettes, but unfortunately, more and more individuals are now starting on electronic cigarettes, and that may lead to further problems with addiction in the future.